في الختام، يعني ما هي الكلمة الأخيرة التي تريد أن توجهها يعني لأهالي المعتقلين؟
Well, I would say
أنا أود أن أقول
Sorry, was there more to the question? Sorry.
What is the message that you'd like to direct to the families of the detainees?
Shall I just answer or do you want to ask the question again?
Go ahead and answer. Do it. Answer.
I would say don't give up hope.
لا تفقدوا الأمل. هذه فترة أليمة ومظلمة من تاريخ الولايات المتحدة، ومرة ثانية أقول من خبرتنا وأنا كنت جزء من هذا في بريطانيا، الناس ممكن تقوم بعمل فرق. هذا هام لأن الشعب الكويتي يتظلم ويعترض. في نهاية اليوم سؤال غوانتانامو دائما كان سؤال سياسي أو مشكلة سياسية. احنا سمينا الفيلم هذا خارج القانون لأن احنا في الفعل أخذنا خطوة خارج القوانين الدولية، والطريقة الوحيدة لحل هذا المشكل. فتشجيعي لدولة الكويت هو أن هو تابعوا على أولادكم الاثنين الباقين هناك.
يعني هل تؤمن بهذه القضية، يعني أنها قضية إنسانية أو يعني أن يعني بالنسبة لك هي قضية مهنية بما أنك محامي، يعني هل ستفعل كل ما لديك لإخراج المعتقلين أم أنك ستقف بمنتصف الطريق ربما؟
Well.
حسنا، هذا بالفعل قضية إنسانية. أنا محامي دولي مع عدة من الموكلين الكبار اللي بعمل معهم. احنا دائما كنت بقول أنا بهتم كثيرا لفايز وفوزي، وأنا بقوم بعمل هذا من أجلهم. أنا أيضا بهتم بالولايات المتحدة الأمريكية. أمريكا دائما وقفت لأشياء جيدة كثيرة، وأنها يجب أن تكون هذا الضوء للحرية. وأنا كأمريكي يجب أن أدفع أمريكا أن هي تعود إلى مبادئها، وأحاول أن أخرج فايز وفوزي. حتى أن فايز وفوزي يخرجوا، أمريكا لم تعش أو لم تقوم وتتبع مبادئها.
نشكر لكم يعني حضوركم هنا ونشكر لكم هذه الإنسانية الرائعة. شكرا لكم جزيل الشكر. مشاهدينا شكرا للمتابعة، ولكن سنترككم مع لقطات من الفيلم Outside the Law.
The largest group of prisoners rounded up and sent to Guantanamo, almost a third of the prison's entire population, were captured in the space of a week, crossing from Afghanistan into Pakistan in December 2001. This was just after a conflict in Afghanistan's Tora Bora Mountains, where remnants of Al-Qaeda and the Taliban had been holding out against US forces. And typically everybody who was captured was tarred as a member of Al-Qaeda and the Taliban as a result. Now the problem with this scenario is that there were many, many more people other than just fighters who were fleeing from the death and destruction in Afghanistan following the US-led invasion and the fall of the Taliban.
We thought the bomb would go for a while and then everything would end up, finish, and just things go back to normal. So I didn't really rush to go out. But when it continued, there was people were serious about invading the country. So I had to leave. I left the country with my wife to where? To Lahore, Pakistan. Obviously, Lahore is very, very, very far away from the borders. It's nothing like a border. I was like caught in the borders or anything like that. I was in a large villa, rented a villa, going out and in without any, you know, like I wasn't hiding. I was going every morning out to buy bread, buy things for my wife. My small kids, 6 months old, are so happy. I really enjoyed even Pakistan. I liked it.
The same system of bounty payments was being made available in Pakistan as was in Afghanistan, and with the same terrible results. So Arabs in Pakistan were being pulled off buses, were being seized in the street, were being picked up in random raids on mosques, and all of them were packaged up as Al-Qaeda and Taliban and sold to US forces. Pakistan's President Musharraf, in his autobiography, admitted that in exchange for handing over hundreds of suspects to US forces, The Pakistani government received millions of dollars.
I was sitting down playing with Suleiman, laughing at him because I had another visitor came from Afghanistan with her sister. She had a small daughter, a very nice daughter, similar age to my son Suleiman. And he was calling Maryam, my wife, saying, come Maryam, just come watch your child is frightened from this Congo kid. And I'm just laughing and joking, it was the middle of the day. Suddenly I hear a scream from Maryam, they're saying, look out from the window, just look out. The police surrounded the house. See, it can't be true. I was scared. I stand up in the window and I see police everywhere, like ants, everyone wearing black and holding guns in their hands. And they surrounded the house and jumped inside the house. And they had, in English, stupidly, not even in Urdu or Pakistani, they had in English in their back written, no fear. The first thing they said is, where's your gun? Where's your gun? I said, I don't have a gun. I have passport and visa. They collected some other people from somewhere else, from other houses, from other places. And things was a shamble and chaos. And then they took us to another high security prison in Lahore. And I was transferred to from there to Islamabad. In Islamabad was another session of torture again for a couple of days, which every time when you come to a new prison, usually torture becomes worse than when it's normal. This guy introduced himself as Andrew, and then he says, I'm British intelligence, MI6 or MI5, I can't remember. I said, I'm a British national, and you're doing this to me. Instead of you helping those who abducted me, kidnapped me here, your job is not to, is to get me out of this place, not to be a a party or to this thing that happens. Say one night they handed us, took us to the airport and then handed us to the American. Suddenly, you know, they say, see Americans shouting. You know, we're in a place like an airport, we can hear the planes. And then suddenly, the hood we had, the Pakistani hood was taken off to another worse hood than the first one. The first hood was very thin and you could have some air. It was a signal of a real hardship. You'd suffocate under that. I remember thrown in the plane. And they used a rope, and you can hear the ee, you know, something like that, where the rope really pulls down, and you can feel it's going to cut you into pieces. And the way they bunked us all on top of each other, it was really, really like you moving furniture or something, because you could feel somebody's leg is in your face, and you're on the floor, and you're chained like that, and there's somebody next to me was throwing up, and you can imagine how suffocated he might have been. And you can sometimes get a kick from somewhere, I don't know what boot comes from where. There are some still guards taking pictures, you know, click, click, you can hear pictures all over, and you can smell alcohol and stuff. And then we were sent down to Bagram, and the new story starts from there, you know, Bagram base, yeah, where all the other horrible stuff.
The first prison that the Americans established in Afghanistan was at Kandahar Airport in southern Afghanistan. But this is where hundreds of the prisoners who ended up at Guantanamo were processed, from December 2001 through to the spring of 2002. At that point, Kandahar was essentially phased out, and Bagram took over as the main prison, where hundreds more prisoners were processed. And Bagram is still the main US prison in Afghanistan to this day.
Bagram is one of the most awful places that you could think of. The first thing that comes to the picture when you think of Bagram is like a concentration camp of what we know of a concentration camp in films. Large barbed placed where they got barbed wires, and then you got large big lights coming down, and then you have generators working all day and night, and it's so cold, and day and night it's cold, and it's difficult to sleep under those lights. And you got people in top of top places where they can look at you down with guns, holding guns on you, and you think this guy's crazy, he might just start shooting any time. It's so frightening because you can hear people screaming every day and night in those top rooms. And under those conditions, and under those circumstances, they were scary, cold, hunger. This is where the British delegate came in and interrogated us. People were like vomiting, I had malaria in my head, the other people were sick, throwing up, toilets were open in front of everybody, you had number one, number two, you know, leftovers of human beings thrown in front, people were sick, diseases, everything, torture, people are dragged in front of people, in front of them. Dragged to interrogation, kicked, shouting, screamed all over the place, and under those circumstances, not any other room. They didn't see these things, or they were taken to another part of the camp. And I said to him, just stand up and look. Just stand up and look down there. Look at the camp down there. Just look how it looks. Doesn't it look like the Nazi, you know, conditions and things like, just look at it. And they, like, you know, brought it in. They knew what they were doing was wrong.
Having already failed to screen any of these men through battlefield tribunals, the US authorities then compounded this error by refusing to screen them at all in Kandahar and at Bagram. What happened was that the prisoners were assigned numbers, the numbers were put on lists and were sent to a place called Camp Doha in Kuwait, where senior figures in the military and the intelligence services were overseeing the whole project. And the orders that came back from there stipulated that every single Arab who came into US custody had to be sent to Guantanamo. There were no exceptions. Any doubts about who they were unanswered at the time, and in many cases remain unanswered to this day.
We were kept there for 2 months, not allowed to speak at all. And if they saw me, there were a couple of guards. Some guards used to even lie, say, "I saw you speak, come here, stand up," just because they didn't like you or something like that, because somebody felt probably you were too proud, or probably they sensed something like that, and they say, him, he used to speak, I saw him speak, just come here. And what they do is, like, they chain you to the chains, you know. There's a place where, really horrible, you know, they got barbed wires, they chain you to the barbed wires. And they put this cover, the black cover, and they tie it. You can feel suffocating, and you could feel your face burning and sweating, and you'd be like, just imagine even more than that, and your hand would be just chained up like that, and in a way, very, very hard, stressful way. And this did happen not only once or twice, but let's say tens of times, you know, it happened. Because every time they see me speak, they'd say, come down to the chains, and they chain you. And it was, you can't keep quiet for 2 months. I mean, it's impossible. I mean, we used to speak, yes. Sometimes they caught us, sometimes they didn't. But when they caught us, the punishment was really, it wasn't easy. I think that was hard. The suffocation part of things was hard. And if, obviously, the electricity shocks and things like that, they'll joke about it. They'll come down with the gun, and you don't know what's going on because you can't even see. And somebody just hit you with a gun. And it's like, you know, you can hear the scream crossing the whole camp. It's so hard that you fall down from it. And they'll just laugh. They just make it like a joke, and they come around doing it. And all sorts of stuff, you know, the water standing up and throwing the buckets of cold water in the wind and things like that. There's all sorts of awful things used to happen there. I think Bagram was probably even worse than Guantanamo. Yeah, it was a bad place.